their wealth and themselves.
We've been in our lives, we think it's us.
Father, we bless you. We give you the glory, the honor, and adorations. We thank you for granting us the grace to gather together in your name. You said we must not forget to come in together as the day is approaching. You said, behold how good and pleasant it is for the brethren to dwell together in unity. We thank you, Lord, for the anointing that is flowing out of unity. We thank you, Lord, for your grace that is being perfected in our lives and through our lives. In Jesus' name we have prayed. And everybody say,
amen.
Amen. You can take your seats. God bless you. Greetings to you all in the name of Jesus. Amen. Turn to the person next to you and say, you look better than last Sunday. To the other one and say, I see Jesus in your face. Amen. Praise the Lord. Not only that, the stature of a person he wants us to be. It's a preparation to our own maturity. You see, our maturities as we are seated here is not the same. It's not the same. Everybody matures according to your destiny. God will, because he knows the devils you are going to face. So he will prepare you according to the devils that lies ahead of you. Not only that, the goal he wants you to fulfill. So he fashions you. So what, when the unfortunate on human side, when God prepares you, he does not owe me an explanation. That is the tough part. He doesn't. If God can tell you, you see now, I'm causing this person to disappoint you and these people to do this, because you see, you're going to become a president, or you're going to become an apostle. At least, you just receive this uppercut and blows from nowhere. Nobody explained anything to you. You cannot just coordinate. These are puzzles that are puzzling you. That's how tough it is. So mentally you are just dislocated, but with God is locating. And he doesn't explain. So he had to teach me how to trust God from a wealthy church, by the way. My pastor is the first mayor of Soweto, so they're not talking about it. God will cause you to learn poverty in a rich church. Rubbing shoulders with big people, highly respected. I prayed for powerful guys. Some of these guys are shareholders of Gautrain. I mean, I'm connected. I'm connected. But you know what? God will disconnect you. Because you see, you will use this human resource as your level of faith. I'm trusting God for this, because you know you've got a guy who has got a share. SAA, I know them. They respect. I prayed for them. God has healed them. But I can't go and extort money, because you know what I'm talking about. I must sit in my corner and go through my things like the rest of other people. When you navigate these people, your journey of preparation never ends. Did you get that? Yeah. If you are going to use a human way to help God, God, you can't dribble God. It will take you, instead of 3 weeks to the promised land like the children of Israel, it will take you 40 years. Because you don't want to go God's way, which is humanly the hard way. You want to go the soft way. You don't want pain. You want gain. So I had to trust God for a toothpaste. I never phoned my home, because definitely it will depress them to know that I'm out there in missions. I don't even have a toothpaste. I don't even afford a bottle or a can of Coca-Cola. So what used to happen is, in that team of 18, for example, that I told you, you know, we were only three blacks. But you know, It's not 18, they were bigger than that. So, but in my team, I was the black person. And others belong to other teams. So when they buy Coke and chocolates, you know, they like chocolates and Coke. So they will have, don't you want a sip? So I'll go. Don't you want a bite? Until I was tired to bite like a dog. You know, when you start your innocence, along the line, this is not it. Why these people can't buy me mine?
I mean,
it doesn't make sense. But God will cause them not to think that way. And you'll be angry with them.
Amen.
Until I said, I remember in my prayer, you don't know our private prayers, eh?
Amen.
What we pray. The curses from these Christians like never before. I cursed them and they died. Because we are so angry. But God ignores certain prayers. He ignores them. You want to kill your enemies? You'll find them fresh. Who were in doctor's room? Who were you? Because you, the more you curse, the more you it
bothers
you.
But
I'm fresh. They got the joy of the Lord. Because they're doing the will of God by
amen.
So I went back. I said, God, I'm tired of sips. I'm tired of bites. I was very angry. You know, when you pray like that, you are not good with God. It's like God is some nice Mickey Mouse whom you must shout at. But God is humble, ne? He never come back with a big clap and give you a nice hiding to teach you how to respect the elderly. So he just listens and I guess he doesn't hear, he turns a deaf ear because we just do not know. One day he will explain. So I got tired. So he doesn't answer me? You know, when he doesn't answer, we answer ourselves. Prayers, some of the prayers that are not answered, you have the answer. If it's on God's side, you will answer. If it doesn't, you ask yourself, you answer yourself. So I said, no more. No more sips. No more bites. So the following day, because they're used to you, you want a bite?
And you
don't bite not smiling because they may not give you tomorrow. You must bite like you enjoy their bites. So they start, hey, Azri. Do you want a bite? I said, I'm okay.
Nothing right.
And only then that God started supplying.
Amen.
Until we kill what we call dependency on men, we will never have dependency on God, which is called faith. Faith is entirely dependency on God. And sometimes it's hard when you do not have to depend on God. I remember when we arrived in KwaZulu-Natal, because we traveled throughout Southern Africa. By God's grace, He made me to know the Cape Towns that are going afford. The poor man going to Cape Town, PE, East London, you name it all, Bloemfontein. I mean, God, at times God may not give you the hard cash, but may enable you by His grace to do and be in places where money could have taken you. So he had still supplied. The only thing, it didn't come as a cash. It came as a provision in a different form. So sometimes when we are thanking God, we want to thank God for the things that landed on our actual hands. Then we decide. Sometimes he doesn't do that because we may mislocate it. We may not use it for what we ask him for. So he knows us better. He rather takes us there. Because actually we have got so many needs that you are supposed to trust God for. So you may decide to divert and still come back. Hey Lord, I want to go to Cape Town. You, I gave you last week. You use it for something else. So I'd rather take you to Cape Town. So in our team we had a car. Amongst other cars. It was called Napoleon Fall Apart.
Babies are Napoleon Fall Apart.
Yes, Napoleon Fall Apart. That was our car. It was a Volkswagen station wagon. Yellow.
Amen.
No, it was that son. You know the famous color brownish. That had a stripe that is more like a Venish wooden type. Baby, no, it was a Volkswagen. Yes, I'm sure now. No more changing. And this car, when we went uphill, it will lose power. And it can get stuck anytime because it was more than just a second hand. I think it was a 10th hand. So it will have to, when we realize there's a hill there, we must, when we're going downward, we must start praising. And you are no longer praising the praise of praise. It's the praise of moving Volkswagen for Napoleon Fall Apart. And by the time it goes up, we praise harder. And then it looks like it wants to stop. And you go, and then it goes up. What was God teaching us? He was teaching us when you can no longer afford anything, even servicing the car, God still is your service.
Amen.
You know, God can still fix a car, supernatural. Only when your purpose is right. Only when he can fix your watch for you to arrive on time. As long as everything is falling along the line of his purpose, therefore everything will harmonize to his vision.
And will
travel from, I mean, Johannesburg, Devon, from Devon, because you know how to connect if you're going to, the shortcut once you're in Devon is to Cape Town. Then to come to Joburg, and then you go to Cape, it's longer.
Amen.
And that's how we went. And the car traveled through praise until it came back to Joburg.
Yes, Kubi Moti Hambanjing and Dumiso, Sasa Buya at Joburg. Amen.
I to trust God for the toothpaste. I to trust God for the cloth. When we arrived there in Devon, God touched a pastor there. He came with a box of clothes. Straight, amongst others, straight to me. Amongst others, straight to me. I had clothes for myself. And also, God made me now a giver. I was able to contribute towards the floods too, so that God can bless me with it.
Amen.
So, at times when we say, Lord, I want to serve you. I want to do your will. And you must know it's your will. Not my will. And at times the will of God is not our will. And we may not be willing to do his will. Because what we had at the back of our minds about his will is totally different. So when he begins to make us trust him for a toothpaste, trust him for a taxi fare, I have fellowshipped in Orlando, staying in Diploof.
Orlando, ngihlale Diploof.
I did Bible school there.
Bible school.
And it was in the evening.
Wakuntambama.
And you know what? I will trust every day for a taxi fare. I will pray in my room. And nobody shows up. The time to go has arrived. So I have to go if I'm really trusting God. So I'll come out of my house with a mind that somebody along the line will just show up. And nobody shows up. Get on the road and hope that somebody will show up. And sometimes somebody did. The car will just stop. Sometimes no car stopped until I arrived there. Because God wanted me to have some nice aerobics so that I may not have high and heart attack. Still, God has supplied me what? The energy to move. So when I arrive there, he grants me the wisdom and says, go to the gents' room and dust off the dust so that you must appear like I have supplied. You know, when you trust God, you are trusting God. And when you have asked God, you are not asking men. Sometimes you can take an advantage. You know what I'm trusting God for? We are tell pela wena. We are tell utshela uNkulunkulu. Usebenzisa nje for guilty conscience on the people. So you have to keep it. So appear there. You know those lights that are bright, you know, when you go to Bible school, they're bright. Fluorescent lights. They looked, your shoe is obvious. They shouldn't see that you got, you know, 3 coats of dust. Because you have traveled in good times and in bad times. And finally you have arrived. So I go in, dust off. It's still the same God. Go and dust your shoes. Go and smile like everything else okay. And when the Bible school is on, don't appear like you are stressed about where you're going to get a taxi fare from. Smile like nothing. Crack jokes like you're used to. If you are really believing me. So crack jokes, then the taxi will arrive to take the rest of the students who pay money. Me, I don't. So I say, hey, see you, go ahead. Me, I've got a private car waiting for me around the corner. Gone. And I'll walk and walk. Sometimes, somewhere halfway, a car just come out of the way. In those days, you know, when 9 o'clock, you will not find a car on the road. In our days, you will not find a car on the road. Early 80s, not find a car, and that is risky. And this guy will just be moving, then you just see this guy walking. Because otherwise, I'll wait forever. God must find me on the move. For the sea to part, I have to walk into that water. And it will stop, then finally the God has provided. And there will be moments when I'm trusting God for taxi fare to go to church. So this time it's on Sunday morning. Do the same walk. By the way, I finished my Bible school. That's how I finished my Bible school. The same trust it had to be for the very Bible school fee.
Amen.
Bible school, and you don't tell people. Month end, we're being called one by one to come and pay. I said, Lord, may I be number last? Maybe in between us that we're being called, somebody will show up. Either through the door or from the students. And nobody shows up. And finally they say, Alfred. I say, yo. As I walk, I say, Lord, may they just decide, no, 10. They didn't take. It's true. It's exactly what was going through in my mind. So I will arrive there. Then when I arrive, I got a little sharp like a smile. This is a free gift. I can pay with my smile. Smile can make you go through, you know, the SAA gates and go to your destination.
Yeah.
I've had roadblocks and I knew here. I'm in for a jump. I just open and just hit by smile and a joke. So it's a
mile.
So remember, in faith, there's joy. Yeah?
Amen.
Use what you have. God will give you what you do not have. So I arrived there. I'm standing. He's seated there, the dean. He says, Alfred, pay, Pella. And during that time, I'm asking God to give me a word that will make me escape this thing. So, and God says, no, just as open your mouth. Whatever comes out, I will. I said, look, I cannot go and take the money for the bread of the children at home and come here and pay for my Bible school. It's either we're hungry at home, or I'm at Bible school. Or I'm at Bible school, we're hungry at home. So I've chosen that we must eat at home, and I must still be in Bible school. And
he says,
I said, the Lord has made.
Amen.
And you know what happened later? He calls me. He said, the pensioner I decided to pay for you. From a rich age, God decides to touch a pensioner. Because he's teaching you humility. Expectations. Visas receptions. Contradiction at its worst. At times when he humbles you, he's also teaching you how to hear him. He's also teaching you his ways that are not your ways. He's also teaching you the vessels he will use versus the vessels you will expect. That money may not be where you are expecting it. Maybe where you are expecting it is debt. Car is a debt, the house is a debt, the clothes is 24 months to pay those socks and the stockings that are torn up. It's all scholar that you see. And do you think these people are Jehovah Jireh? They are also trusting God for a miracle for themselves. And the people with the money is those pensioners that are sitting there. Because it's theirs, they buy by cash. The other ones, they buy by revolving credit. Sometimes he's teaching you that. You know, perception versus reception. What you see is not necessarily what you get. And then he says, the pensioner asked not to be known. Then it was tough. So I must behave myself. I was more cautious of two people. If generous three, one God, two that pensioner, and three my pastor. You just do not know how to behave. Because that person is looking at you. And two, I will not want that person to regret for obeying God in meeting my needs. Until today, ladies and gentlemen, I do not know who provided for my Bible school
fee.
But what I know, I think it was a she. That's number one. Number two, I think she has passed on. Number three, I think she loved me too. Number four, I think I used to frequent meeting her. She was good at disguising that I could only suspect. I never picked it up. And I know number five, I think she was in Diplof Extension. We had people all over, but I think she was in Diplof Extension. Number six, I think she was proud about where her money went. The value of the money is not on the amount. It's on the need. When you are down and broken, like last week, for example, even that Sakile was talking as a deer panteth for the water. Those words were like water out of someone who is dehydrated.
So,
those words, when you are full on the okay, it's nothing, you can easily forget. But when you desperately need a drop of water, every drop counts. So the value of the water is not determined by the Department of Water.
Amen.
Neither by Valpri price of water.
Is
how thirsty and dehydrated you are. And at times God has to put you there where you have to not only value a bottle or a glass of water, you have to learn to value a drop. Remember the story of a rich man and the poor Lazarus. This guy, the rich man, he cries for just a drop of water. He says, Father Abraham, ask Lazarus just to get me just a drop of water. It's not that when you are desperate, you are no longer asking for a glass. Because a glass is too expensive.
Cry
for a drop. At times, God will humble you.
It
may cause you to have your house repossessed to learn a lesson. Your car to be repossessed. You to lose the job. And it's the same God who provides. Because your preparation is based on your destiny and the kind of the maturity he wants out of you. So he might start you all over again. So as we cry for a place and a purpose in our lives, sometimes you say, Lord, I've changed my mind. Unfortunately, the Bible says God is not man that he can change his mind. When God purposes himself to do something with you, you can bind, you can go to any anointed man that you can think of. There's no anointing that will move God. You can go for any deliverance. There is no casting that can cast out the spirit of God. Even the devil, he's afraid of God. The Bible says even demons, they fear him, his name, and they tremble. So that's why after God has done a certain milestone with your goal and your life, and he starts using you, he gets seriously jealous with you. Because you are more of a vessel of honor, not only mainly on the basis of behavior, but the investment he has made in making you what you are a clay that has turned into a pot from the potter's hand. He can rather have 3 million dead than to have you dead. These vessels are not the same. It goes with the material, the time, that is spent in making it. Sometimes even that very vessel, when it wants to give up the ghost, it can't die. Because God says, my investment is too much. It will take me another 40 years. And where will this nation be? By the time I have prepared another vessel to use. And that's why even in the midst of it all, when he has done much, you find some people that don't have to ask anything any longer. Things are just there. Do you know why? He's not supplying necessarily to the person. He's supplying to the investment which is called ministry. And because he has worked on this clay, he has broken, as David says, a contrite in Psalm 51 and a broken spirit, he will not ignore. This thing, you know, some people, you have a car, you have whatever you have, you can literally see it even when they are not there. They are somewhere in extension 4. You can actually see a car in them, even they're walking on foot. You can see their house. But they don't. Do you know why? Because God has squashed them, melt them, molded them, made them. He has killed every pride. He has killed anything you can think of. That's called self. That's why Paul says it's no longer I who live. It is Jesus who lives in me. I'm dead. And you know what caused Paul to die? Yo. He speaks about being stoned. He speaks about being betrayed. All these things, it was still the making of Paul, or of Saul into Paul. And you know what Paul means? It means the little one. That's why he says, amongst the sinners, I'm the chief. And amongst the saints, I'm the least. God will belittle you. I want you to remember that. Jesus. He will fashion you. He's good with fashion making. He will make you exclusively his. You know the price of having a tailor-made suit and a dress? It's expensive because it's tailor-made for your body. It's not one size fits all. He will make you separate.
Amen.
They will see God's hand on you. What does that mean? It's not only anointing. They will say this one has been smashed not by train but by God. It's a smashed potato. Even people will say, how can you allow these things to happen to you? What are you talking about? They say, we know you. What has happened? Who will be with you? You will not allow all this nonsense. Because God has dealt with you. Preparations of God. There's a calling. There's a preparation. Then there's a release. Calling is very easy. Everybody, when they call, they feel like starting now. But you know what? That's why you see so much that is happening in ministry today. It's like having a fruit before it's ripe. Because the stomach ache problems, complications. People are called, but they are not ready for ministry. You can literally see them. You see, preparation has got nothing to do with how you preach. It has got something to do with who you are. It has nothing to do how to preach. So Bible school is not preparation. It's information for preparation.
Amen.
Did you get that one?
Amen.
Person from Bible school, you are full of Greek and Hebrew. You are full of verses. Those are verses. It's just like the vest that you have it on for you to be warm.
Ama verse njokwele ngao.
You're full of verses. But until the verse become part of your skin, you have not benefited from it. And
a
lot of people, they run away. I call it the Bible school of God. After Bible school, from Bible school, you need to go to Bible school from God. Let's have a look at it. Matthew 4. And you know, when it comes to calling and preparation, a special preparation, we do not choose. I'm telling you the truth. It's just like anyone in a classroom who feel like running away from school through the window.
So
exactly like that in preparation. Because your expectations, your expectations, visas your experience. Oh, you just said, Lord, is this what I said yes to? I think I made a mistake. And unfortunately, you can't come out. In this classroom, there's butler doors and butlers on the window. You can't come out. There's only entrance, there's no exit. At least here, there's a fire escape. There, no fire escape. You bad. You get fried there. Tenderized, marinated. You can't get out. I don't know how many times I was giving up here. But here I am, I'm standing here. I'm asking myself, who is preaching this message? Is it me? Am I okay? I think you must be shocked. This okay? I don't know. Ask God if I'm okay. My wife behind the scene, she knows how many times I resign. I feel like going somewhere. I can't go to Pretoria, it's too far. If I can find just a hall somewhere. And I found it, here is it.
Amen.
And you know, when these things happen, God is silent. He doesn't talk, you know, he just keeps quiet. Can I use a strong word? Because it's the only available for me. I feel like he's stubborn, you know. Just. He's laughing, Mara. Yo, that love is strong. I just said, no, no, no. I just want to spend my next 10, 5 years somewhere. Because I can't take out this calling. At least let me go and use it somewhere. I said, maybe I'll find different results. Mara, here I am. I don't know what I'm doing here. Standing here.
Amen.
It's tough. But it is possible.
Amen.
I remember hearing this somewhere earlier. You know, sometimes you don't know whether it's earlier hours or what. But I know there are certain scriptures that God brings, that you think you know. I remember that word. Verse 1. Matthew 4, verse 1. Then Jesus was what? Led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. That is preparation. And this preparation, it always comes a nice glory. For every glory, there is a gloom on the way. If you have watched every good times in the presence of God, every breakthrough, there's a breakdown around the corner. It was like, oh God, I thought we have it made. What's this now? And that joy flashed through the window. Sometimes you feel like your winter is longer than your summer. But that is what preparation is. When you are in the wilderness, a minute, it feels like a 1 week. Everything when you are in the wilderness is exaggerated. I hope you are here. You know, anyway, you don't need to hear. You know.
Amen.
In one way or the other, every one of us have their own wilderness moments. And every second it feels like 1 month. Every 1 hour it feels like a year. Your night is longer than your day. That's why it says weeping may enjoy for a night. Yo, it doesn't say you will enjoy for a night. Hey, do you understand the enjoy? Endurance is so much it takes a lot of toll. You feel like that night is longer than the day. You even think there's a lot shedding in heaven. You feel like God bring the sun here. It has been too dark too long. Everything goes feels like so slow. The promises of God feel so slow. People who promised you things that they will do so slow. Your month end never comes. If it does end, it never ends. That's what wilderness is. And it's coming after what? It's coming after a good time. After Jesus was baptized in Matthew chapter 3, after experiencing a voice of God that this is my son in whom I'm well pleased. Wow, after all, well pleased, throw you in the oven. Well pleased, throw you in anarchy. And you are saying, Lord, you. What's up? There he was quiet in the wilderness. No voice of God. If you listen here to chapter 4, the book of Matthew, in the wilderness, there's more devil who speaks than God. God backs off, it disappears. Your enemy appears because you have been sent to prepare you. So in preparation, it's not only God alone. Actually, God sent the devil by his assignment. Do you remember the wilderness of Job? When Job had to go through the wilderness, who went there? It's the devil. And God said to him, when he asked of him, he says, go. Go and deal with him. But don't touch his soul. Touch everything. In the wilderness, everything falls apart. Do you hear what I'm saying? Except you. If you do, you fall apart on your outward look. You get sick. You try to pray. The more you pray, you get more sick. I know we are preaching the gospel of prosperity and faith. That's exactly what I'm doing now. You have got headaches, you take tablets. The tablets, they come back to you, says this headache is also giving us a headache.
Oh, no,
we're talking about wilderness. Yeah, they know you, mighty man and mighty woman of valor, highly anointed. You are drinking tablets like Smarties, and nobody knows. If you are married, it's only your partner knows, and if you dare and talk, she will get what she deserves. You know, wilderness. Oh. No mighty woman of valor. No mighty man of valor. This whole confession in the wilderness, I echo. What did Jesus say in the wilderness? If it is your will, let this cup pass from me. The Son of God, praying and scriptural prayers. Those who exaggerate, they said, God sent an angel and whispered to him, they say, hey, pray God's will. Then he said, nevertheless. That was a U-turn, how many U-turns have you taken? You said, no more to this church, I'm gone. You U-turn. We are spinning now. And those people are waiting for you on the other side. No more. You know what I'm talking about. You are not alone. We did it too. I'm a no more. God does not listen to any prayer that is contrary to his will. He knows you. He knows you are lost. You are drugged by a moment. Emotion of a moment. You are intoxicated. When you are sober, you speak sense. Nevertheless, I'm telling you, the biggest in the wilderness, there's the two battles. The battle of wills. Are you getting that? The battle of wills.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Battles of wills. That's why he says, let this cup pass from you. But nevertheless, set your will. I'm telling you, it's the will of God that will prevail. Your will is not powerful. There are certain wills of God that have prevailed over our wills. And we are still enjoying what we didn't want today. God's will. And we look back, we say, if I could have gone my way, if God could have answered my will, that is wilderness. Now, one of the things that I felt God was talking about wilderness in my life. He said, Jesus, can you imagine? Jesus is the lifespan of a wilderness is determined by how strong is your will versus God's will.
Number two, the
wilderness of Joseph was the wilderness of the graveyard, of the pit. How long Joseph spent time in the pit was determined by the kinds of the prayers he prayed while he was in the pit. And when he prayed God's will in the pit, it accelerated the Ishmaelites to come to his rescue out of his brothers. If he could have resisted longer, Joseph could have been killed by his brothers.
Yeah.
So don't be too hard too long. It may work against you. There are big fives. There are men and women of God who have gone through that wilderness. Jesus was not the first one. The other one that comes into my mind is David. His father, the Bible says, the Spirit of God led Jesus to the wilderness. Actually, he says into. In other words, he was dropped. He didn't walk himself there. The Spirit of God caught him against his will and said, I want to deal with you for 40 days and 40 nights with your willpower. You are too strong for me to use.
Sure.
Because your will is you. How much God will use you is dependent on how strong is his will over your will. That's where lordship comes in.
Yeah, amen.
You cannot have him as Lord and still have it your way. He says, my ways are not your ways. My thoughts. So it's a will and a thought pattern. God wants to own these two. So, some of us, like my personality, the April man, we are strong, we are toughies. So when God comes, he must not use a digging fork, a spade. He must use a five, not even just a hammer, neither a tomahawk. It won't work here. He knows 5, 10 pounds, not five. We need 10 pounds, 25 pounds, hammer. So God knows the kind of out of big five. Which one? There are some people which a lion won't work. A cheetah won't work. You want an elephant god. When it comes, boom.
Boom.
That's what God has crushed. I look in the spirit like a train. How train has walked over me. And we don't die smiling. You have seen me. I look like I've been made up by an elephant. You see, the harder we are, the more cruel God, I'm using that word, he becomes in smashing us. Because you see, what is precious in his sight is the outcome. It's not what we are going through. He's like a potter. He's like an artist who is drawing a picture. So he puts your outcome picture there. And as he's drawing the kind of the picture. So he's merciless about the present status. Because that outcome is what comforts him. It's not your screaming. It's not your stubbornness. It's not your kicking. It's not your curses. It's not your vows that are unscriptural. It's not show offs that you are making. God is not scared of that. It's the goal that drives him. So he takes his own son Jesus. Can you imagine? He takes his own son Jesus by his spirit, Holy Spirit, not heaven. Did you get that one?
Amen.
There is the Holy Spirit that takes him to some form. Before I give you an assignment, you are assignment number one. Because for that assignment to be achieved, it's dependent on how pliable, flexible, twistable. I can't work with you like this. I must deal with you first. Before I deal with the devil. Before you deal with the devil, you are the devil number one. Didi. So if he takes Jesus, why can't he take you and me? If it took 40 days for Jesus to become the Christ, the Son of the living God, who says, I'm here to do my Father's will. Will alone. No longer my will. If it took Jesus, who had no sin, who never committed one, you and me, who sin, who commit so much, it's more than 40 days. we take time. Our wilderness is longer.
Lord, receive me.